Hey, what's up, guys? Welcome back to the channel. It's your boy F6. We got another hero overview guide for you today on Crunch. We're going to go over the strengths and weaknesses of Crunch, kind of how to build him, going over the abilities, his combos, and a little bit of tips and tricks about the hero. So I hope you guys do enjoy the video. If you guys like it, hit that like button, subscribe. It helps me out a lot. And let me know what you guys think about in the comments down below. Let's get straight into it. So to fully understand a hero, I believe the passive is where you need to start with. So we're going to start with that here today. So Crunch's passive is called Cross Crunch. After casting ability, Crunch amplifies his next basic attack to deal bonus magical damage and reduce current cooldown by 1 second. It might be a little bit hard to read because you see this scaling with 15% on physical and magical. What that's telling you is just, hey, if you have magical damage in your items or physical, you're able to scale off of that. So you're able to scale off 30 magical power and scale off 30 physical power. But the damage output from the actual passive itself is going to be magical damage. And that's probably a little bit confusing to most people. So I just wanted to clarify that. And on top of that, you reduce your cooldowns by 1 second after you cast your ability. Right there, that's free ability haste in your kit. Right now, just from that, you can kind of just understand that Crunch wants to do a bunch of damage to you and spam his abilities, right? We are going to skip here a little bit and going to talk over to Crunch's ultimate ability. For you to really understand his entire base abilities, we need to understand the ultimate first, right? So Crunch's ultimate is going to be Recrunch. His passive is every third basic attack or ability hit against a hero or monsters heals Crunch for a certain number. It does scale with physical and magical. You'll see that trend throughout his entire kit. There's a secondary passive towards it. Every third ability used will be empowered if used within 10 seconds, meaning you have a 10 second window from casting one of your abilities to do the rest of his kit to get a combo off on the third one. There's an active with it as well. Repeat the last basic ability used. What this means is if you were using his right crunch or left crunch and that was the last ability you spammed, you're going to use it again. Crunch's basic attack, he deals standard basic attack, pretty decent scaling. It's going to be 80% physical scaling, which is pretty nice. And you're just going to do a standard physical damage in the game. So let's talk about Crunch's alternate ability, his forward crunch. You're going to dash forward, dealing physical damage. Colliding with an enemy hero stops Crunch and stuns them for 0.25 seconds. It is a great ability to close the gap or try to run away. But do keep in mind, you can dash through minions with your RMB. It does stun the minions as well if you just kind of wanted them to stop attacking you. Whenever this ability is empowered, you dash an extended distance, pushing enemy heroes on contact. So it's not necessarily that you stun them, but you're able to take an enemy out of where they want to be and reposition them. For instance, if you were to do your combo and the empowered that comes from your ultimate is a passive in there, it's going to push them further than the direction that you were dashing. Crunch's primary ability is going to be left crunch. Crunch swings, dealing physical damage to the first enemy hit and 50% to the subsequent targets. Empowered, this damage is dealt as true damage and deals 100% to subsequent targets. So left crunch is able to hit more than one enemy. This is your primary damage ability throughout. Even if you're in the jungle or in your offlane, this is going to be your primary wave clear and your primary damage output. The fact that when this is empowered, you do true damage, and not only that, anybody within that area, it's a pretty nice cone swing as well, especially when it's empowered. But you're able to damage everybody the same amount, and you're just able to just fight into these bigger team fights a lot better. Crunch's secondary ability is going to be right crunch. Crunch jabs, dealing physical damage to all nearby enemies, slowing them by 60% for 1.2 seconds. If this is empowered, uppercut enemies nearby, knocking them out for 1.2 seconds. This ability right here is ridiculous. A lot of the times when you're getting uppercutted, this is the ability that Crunch is using, and most of the time they're using their combos in the right sequence to get the empowered effect of uppercutting you. But not only that, this thing applies a slow whenever it's not empowered. you can just see throughout Crunch's kit. He has two different types of hard CC, a soft CC with a slow, just depending on if it's empowered or not. And that's really where I think when it comes to the overall Crunch gameplay, a lot of people can't get past a certain threshold. And the big part of it is just understanding the sequence of his abilities to do what you want. So let's talk about Crunch's items, right? How are you trying to build Crunch? There's two very good paths to build Crunch. It's going to be more of an assassin type, and there's going to be the bruiser tankiest type. In my honest opinion, a bruiser Crunch is the better Crunch. He's able to have that sustain and able to fight a little bit more and not get blown up. So he's able to just use more abilities and impact the fight a little better than he is with an assassin. The most builds, we're going to start off with the crest. If you're going to go the assassin crest, the rogue crest, there's not really too much that you want in there. You're gonna kind of be getting the Witch Stalker, so that way you're able to kind of just get a cleanse for yourself, right? We talked about the biggest weakness for Crunch, and that's going to be CC, right? Hard CC is not Crunch's best friend. So to try and mitigate the hard CC, getting a Witch Stalker to cleanse that is your best route on the Rogue Crest. Going on into the Warrior Crest, depending on your matchup, you do have another cleanse in here. You have Brutalis you can use. Most of the time you're going to use that, but if their team doesn't really have a lot of high CC on the hard CC, you're going to be going into Icecorn's talents. Icecorn talents just creates a battle zone for you and just increases your power and movement speed and slows the enemy. So that way you're able to create a nice little dueling zone and kind of just get a little bit more power and just fight into your enemy. A lot of times going into the Phoenix Crest, you're going into a bruiser build, so you won't have that much power as if you were going the assassin type. So having Icecorn talents just to up your damage is great. Not only does it up your damage for you, but for your team as well. Talked a little bit about Brutalix here. That's going to be your cleanse. This also gives you lifesteal, and the fact that most of the time you're going to be going into mutilator and some form of lifesteal in your build, just having the extra 5% lifesteal is great as well. This also gives you 60% tenacity. If you don't know what that is just pretty much if you were to get CC'd for one full second, if you have 60% tenacity, you will only get CC'd for 0.4 seconds. And successful basic attacks extend this duration, and with Crunch, you're always basic attacking in between your combos. So this is very good for him. Keep him from getting CC'd as long and just being able to fight a little bit better into that. There's also Phoenix. I wouldn't recommend this too much. Phoenix does give you an extra life, but it kind of just brings you back in the same spot. And most people just kind of just wait for you to get out of your Phoenix and kill you anyways. I don't think this brings a lot to the fight. Maybe if you have a execute laner that you're going against, maybe like a Shindy, or you're going against a Kalari, and you're just trying to just survive the last initial damage that they're going to do, like Kalari's E, Shinbi's ult, or Morgish result, that's kind of where you're going to build that. So it's a very specific kind of scenario where you're trying to just negate somebody's last hit, last stitch effort of damage. So now that we talked a little bit more about the crest, understanding which one you're trying to pick depending on your matchup and your playstyle, let's go into the items. Your first items, majority of the time, is going to be Mutilator. So if you don't know what Mutilator does, it gives you 40 physical power, 15 ability A's, and 8% Omnivamp. The physical power is great. Like I said, most of your abilities scale more with physical power, so it's good to build on the physical power side of things. You get 15 ability haste. We talked about Crunch's passive, being able to get your cooldown by 1 second. Now that you're spamming your abilities, you're able to also get the passive to get more cooldowns going, so you're able to spam your abilities more, which is great. The 8% Omnivamp, that lifesteal coming in from your abilities, is fantastic. And the passive coming in off of Mutilator, the first one, Mutilate basic attacks deal 1% of the enemy hero's maximum health as bonus physical damage, applies twice on non-DOT abilities. So you're doing 2% of every ability that you're going on Crunch onto the enemy hero. So you're taking like 2% of the maximum health additionally on top of the enemy that you're fighting. So you're pretty much bursting people down based off of percentage health pen. Then the second ability, Devour, damaging an enemy hero with an ability steals 5% of their maximum health for 20 seconds. Can only occur once per target. So yes, you can only do this once per target, but once you initially do the damage. So you go in and initiate. You have 20 seconds of 5% extra health that you've taken away from your enemy and put onto yourself, and gives you the advantage in that fight. So just having that there and gives you 20 seconds to fight somebody with that 5% bonus health is ridiculous. Augmentation is one of the best second items on Crunch. It gives you pretty much everything you need at this point. You've already got the Lifesteal and Omnivamp coming in from Mutilator. Now you need a little bit more health to kind of make yourself a bigger boy. Take a couple extra basic attacks, take a couple of abilities, right? So 300 health is huge. And guess what? You get more ability haste. So the passive on True Strike, after using an ability, your next basic attack within 6 seconds deals 40 total physical power bonus true damage. So not only are you doing true damage on your Q, but now whenever you use an ability, rotate your autos in there, you're able to use the passive of True Strike to get more true damage on top of the enemy hero. For those you don't understand true damage, you cannot mitigate true damage. It doesn't matter if you have 6,000 armor or 7,000 or even one, right? You're going to do that true amount of damage. So let's just say it's 30. There's nothing that can stop that 30 damage output from going through. And now that you're able to cycle it through your empowered Q, and then cycle it through your autos in between those chain attacks, is fantastic. Second passive on augmentation, overclocked. Upon casting your ultimate, gain 20% movement speed for 6 seconds. This is on a 20 second cooldown. At this point, you have 35 ability haste. You're pretty much getting your abilities off quick, especially if you consider your passive going into that minus 1 second. If you're able just to cycle in your autos using your abilities, your ultimate comes back up pretty quick. And every time you use it, you're gaining movement speed. So your chase potential to either get the enemy and kill them or just run away is great. Your third core item is going to be looking more towards Draconum. This is usually roughly based off who your matchup is and what's really the damage output here. So you can either go Draconum or you can go Void Helm. But we're going to dive into Draconum here. Most of the time, this is going to be your third item. You get everything you want here. You get physical power and you get ability haste, stacking on top of what you got through Mutilator and Augmentation. And now you get physical armor. So this is going to help you out as well to just kind of have a little bit more sustain in the fight. Surge on Draconum, the first passive, dealing damage to enemy heroes or monsters, grants you 2 physical power and 2% increased healing for 5 seconds, stacking up to 10 times. So at max stacks, you can get 10 physical power. That's extra. And 20% increased healing for 5 seconds. That is huge. Not only are you increasing your healing from the Mutilator, from your passive of Recrunch, now you get free increased healing, right? So we're trying to just find this synergy inside of our items to make our hero thrive as much as possible. So having just this one passive on Draconum just makes it 10 times better. Your second passive, takedowns, restore 100% of bonus physical power scaling of health. So based on how much physical power you have, if you keep in mind the Draconum that you're getting, you already went into Augmentation, you already went into Mutilator, even Draconum gives you some physical power. That is so much health that you're getting back for free. And if you add that once again on top of all the healing that you're getting, the passive on Draconum, this is just keeping you in the fight. Now you have even health, you have physical armor, you're just a pretty big boy at this point. There's a lot of times when you hit this third item spike, depending on if you go Draconum or Void Helm, you're just able to really do whatever you want as long as you're not getting RCC. Let's talk a little bit more about Void Helm. So if you're versing a magical hero inside the offlane, or there's just a lot of magical on the enemy team and you kind of just want to get that magic resistance up and get yourself a little bit tankier, instead of going Draconum of getting the physical armor, you're gonna go into Void Helm here. The reason why most of the time we choose Void Helm, it's because it gives you increased healing. That's the first passive on it. Also, this thing gives you health, ability haste, like we talked about, like we want, and just your magical armor, right? One of the big things, the second passive, immobilizing an enemy hero restores 3% of your maximum health over 4 seconds. So if you're able to get your combos off a lot and you understand the sequence you need to, every about 3 to 4 seconds, I think it's actually 3 to 5 seconds, you can get an uppercut by immobilizing an enemy, or if you were able to forward crunch into them, immobilizing them for 0.25 seconds, you're still increasing your health regen, right? So this is huge to have, especially when you need a little bit more magical armor. So rounding your entire build out with Stonewall is huge. And we'll get into that. So it's not the fact that it gives you everything you want at this point, right? Most of your damage is coming in from the items you already have, your core items, right? So you're getting a little bit more health. You're getting a little bit more health regen and kind of sustain yourself after you engage and kind of need to kind of set yourself. But you get 70 physical armor. This is huge. It's one of the most you can get in the game other than Citadel, where you kind of just need other things in there to kind of help you out. But Stonewall is huge. And not only that, the passive shockwave, taking damage that would reduce you below 40% maximum health, unleashes a shockwave, stunning all nearby enemies for 1 second. So if you are just in a fight, right, and just getting CC'd to death, and you're like, man, I'm gonna die, Stonewall comes in to try and help you out, stuns everybody for 1 second, allow you to kind of just get out, right? You can either blink out or dash out, or you've already damaged the enemies enough to where now you can kind of just use your recrunch to get a little bit more healing, start using your abilities more, getting basic attacks off, and most of the times you're able to survive, as unless you're like 1v5ing and your team is not around you, right? But this is a great item to have to finish your kit out into that late game. Second passive is take 10 with a plus 5% bonus physical armor, decrease damage from physical abilities. Essentially, with Bulwark, enemies like Grux, Feng Mao, and Kalari, their abilities are dealing less damage to you. This is before they even consider in the armor that you have on, right? And the match or the physical resistance, right? Not only do you have your base armor, but now you have Bulwark just reducing the damage you take. So you have a little bit more sustain in your kit, and it's just fantastic. And I find this just being one of the greatest things that when you're in a longer game and you're getting to the fifth item, you're like, man, I really need this to work. Most of the time, Stonewall is going to be great for you. So there are some other items you can possibly go into if you need to change your build around. So for magical resistance, you can go into Unbroken Will. This is for if you're getting CC'd so much. There's a Steel, right? There's a Bellica. There's just so much CC. There's a deck here. You're just like, man, I just need something to help me, right? So it gives me health. It gives me base health regen. Gives me a little bit of magical armor for me to sustain against these magical types, right? Most of them are going to be Steel, which is magical. Most of these CCs are coming out of these magical users, and just having that little bit of extra magical armor helps out. But one of the best things about this is the 15% tenacity that you do get. So like we talked about with the Brutalix, it just kind of reduces how long you get CC'd by 15%. Big passive though, coming into what really makes this item the item you want, is Undying. When you are immobilized, gain 30% increased total physical armor and total magical armor for 2 seconds. First of all, the fact that you're getting a percent increase is huge, not just a base number. So you're already building into Draconum, and you're already building into a Void Helm. And you just kind of need this item and to increase the armor on top of it. And there's no cooldown or period that you need to use this. So if you're getting constantly CC'd, you are gaining 30% increased armor for physical and magical, which is fantastic. It does wonders. Second passive, if you are immobilized or displaced, meaning if you get pushed back by, let's say, enemy crunch, right? Or you get pushed back by Steel's shield charge, you restore 6% of your maximum health over 4 seconds. Not only do you get more armor, you get health regen. If you have the increased healing off Draconum or Void Helm here, it's just increased by 10% more, right? So 16% of your max health over 4 seconds, right? This is fantastic for you. Gives you everything you need, especially in that late game, to round out your build. All right, so first thing I'm gonna show you guys is how to understand Crunch's passive. You understand Crunch's passive because on his back, doesn't matter which skin, you see his jets start to fire up after you cast an ability once you hit level 6. So if I were to cast my first left crunch, I'm going to come in. You start to see the little boosters on my camp keep going. Now I have another within that 10 seconds to cast another ability, and you see it gets really boosted up. And now I know my next ability is going to be empowered. And that's usually where the uppercut comes in from. But if I were just to use my Q here, one, you see the little boost coming on. Okay, now my fists are really powered up. My next one's gonna be pretty big and a bigger sweep, and you saw the true damage tick. So a lot of times you're just playing off that passive, but a really quick way to remember this is just 1-2 enhance, right? 1-2 enhance, 1-2 enhance. So one ability, two ability, my next ability is going to be enhance. I should play off of that. So let's just say we have a jump pad here. I'm going to be staying in base. If I want to not use a lot of mana and get a better dash distance, I can pre-ant myself up, use the jump pad, jump off. Once I land, press my RMB, and I get a longer dash. So I ended up right around the core without the jump pad. Now, if I were just to kind of go back and I did not use that, I jump off and I dash once I land. There's a big difference on how far I can travel. This kind of helps you rotate as well, just priming yourself up. So if you really need to get to your red side jungle or just get back into the fight, this is the best way to do it coming out of base. One thing you could also do with Crunch is if you're up on the stairs trying to get to an objective, you can just go up the stairs and dash over, because the fall mechanic in this game is not too much and you're just able to just jump over, right? So you'd be able to use that. That'll be useful. Another useful tip for Crunch is if you're playing Crunch, there's no reason not to have your abilities on instant cast. The reason I say this is there is a little bit of latency between normal cast, quick cast, and instant cast. So if you guys don't know, in instant cast, it's when you press the button down that your ability activates. With quick cast, it's when you release your button that the ability activates. That's going to be it for this Crunch Hero overview. I hope you guys liked the video. I hope you guys learned something from this. If you have any questions, leave it down in the comments down below. I'll get back to you. If you liked the video, hit that like button. And if you guys can subscribe, it's totally free. It helps me out a lot. And I'll see you guys on the next one.